Everybody, on this fine October 1st, I got my orange and black on, finally. Well, in our announcements, I've got the prayer vigil is not going to happen this Saturday. Is that correct, folks? A Bible study? No, that will not happen this coming Saturday, okay? So that is a change there. The drive-through Bethlehem planning meeting, we're on the next one we're going to have, is going to be Saturday, October 21st at 10 a.m. Saturday, October 21st at 10 a.m. We've had several, spoke with some of the Nauvoo folks yesterday, and they seemed rather enthused about the idea and everything. So we're going to get some more response from that at that meeting. And plus, I want to thank everybody who signed up last week, and if we can always have more people, okay, just let us know, and we can make plans accordingly. But by the 21st, we'll start nailing down who's going to do what and everything, kind of thing. And my dear wife, who missed Terry Jo with her little pamphlet, okay, is going to speak to you now. Well, she got one, so. Okay. Uh-oh. Get ready, folks. She's got a whole pile of stuff.
I'm sorry. I'll try to hurry. I'm not going to talk about everything today, but we'll spread it out over a month, maybe. But I did have something that I wanted to say. I read the bulletin yesterday that Jamie has back there, and it really blessed me. We had a really good time at the prayer thing yesterday. And we were talking about our children's ministry, and it kind of came up in the conversation with somebody that we wish we had one. And I started thinking, we do have one. We have a great children's ministry here. We just don't have any children right now. And we will get them back in, you know. And we are trying to reach children, even though they're not in the building. And what I wanted to do today is read something and then highlight a few things that we do for the children's ministry, and how that you can feel more a part of it. And this isn't the only week this month that I'll be doing this. I want to do a little bit, focus on a different one every time. I'm just going to give you the broad overview of the things we do today, focus on one of them, and then I'll hush, okay? And the Bible verse on the bulletin today is, we'll tell the next generation all about the praise due the Lord. And that comes from Psalm 78. And so I had that marked in here. Do I still have it marked? I don't know. Anyway, the beginning of that psalm is wonderful. And the more we read scriptures, the better off we'll be prepared. So I encourage you to read your Bible every day. But I'm going to read the first part of that so you can hear the whole thing. It says, O my people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter hidden things, things from of old that we have heard and known, what our fathers have told us. We will not hide them from our children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he recommended our forefathers to teach their children. To the next generation, so that the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born. And they in turn would tell their children, then they would put their trust in God, and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their forefathers, a stubborn and rebellious generation, whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. And what is happening in our country, even in our little community here now, is they are becoming a rebellious generation, and they know nothing about God because they're not being taught. People aren't coming into the churches. The churches aren't going out to tell them because we don't know how. And we're trying to figure that out. And the Bible says in Psalm 119, the Bible is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And the more I read, and this scripture really blessed me, God will light our path. He will make a way to go out and have a children's ministry, which we do have. So I want to focus on a couple of them today. One of them is, Anyway, the children's time with Ann thing that we do, this is a brainchild of Pat Sarasso and Greg Carter. During the pandemic, we had no way to reach our people, so we wanted to have a camera to put the sermons online, and we have our services online so we could all be together even though we were in our homes. So when Pat wrote the grant, she said we'd be putting children's messages online. So we had to do them to satisfy the grant. And when Susan and I first started it, we were going to do a couple lessons and stop, and that would satisfy the grant. But it became like, well, this is an opportunity. And the more we thought about it, we thought, you know, we may have a way to reach children, even though they're not here. So we kept doing them. We now have 71 lessons online. But the thing I wanted to stress about this is that this is not mine and Kevin's and Susan's and Pat's ministry. It's yours. It's all of ours. And I know that some of you retired from work before they had computers in the office. And you don't have a home computer, and some of you don't do a cell phone with the internet on it. But I guarantee you know somebody that has a cell phone that has the internet on it, or that you, because some people are just attached to them all the time. And what I'm asking you to do, because there's a lot of people in here who have watched them and are telling people about them, but it would be like a restaurant owner that has this wonderful restaurant, and he says, oh, you have to eat this entree, it's great, but they've not tasted it. You know, if you've never watched one, you really don't know what to tell people. And some people like to watch it but don't do the art, and that's okay, I understand that, because the stories are great, Bible stories are wonderful. But you ought to watch one all the way through just so that you'll know what to tell people that it's about. And what we're trying to do, we've developed some brochures, and the Children's Museum is letting us put them there. And Susan said we've had a slight uptick in people watching since we did that. So that's great. And we're trying to do some small brochures. Some of them have all the lessons in them, and that's kind of busy looking. But if you're looking to find a certain lesson, that's a great thing to have. But we're starting to put out smaller ones. This is the new one. I put them in the back. I'm going to ask you to take one and call somebody if you don't have an internet and watch it with them. It will bless you and them. You'll feel more a part of our ministry, because we want this to be your ministry too. It's one that we the outreach. These are about file lessons and object lessons. Most of them are Bible stories that we talk about. We also, we do a lesson, then we say, this is what you can learn from that. Now let's do art to help you remember it, and we have a closing prayer. But you can choose one of these to watch, or you can choose another one. But I ask you to take one at the back and give it to somebody, okay? And then I'm going to real quickly run through some of the other ministries we have, and then each week I'll focus on a different one. Next week, I'm going to focus on Christmas child boxes. But today, because it's time to do that again, folks, I'll put that in your bulletin today. Pete brought them to me today. Trish gave them to me, and that tells you what you can do. We had 21 last week, last year. I can't remember. But I would like to challenge us to do at least that many, maybe at least one more than that if we could. If you don't want to fill a box by yourself, partner with somebody else to fill one or two boxes. I think the shipping has gone up again because it hasn't.
$10.
$10. It's $10 this year to ship a box. And we have the labels back there. If you don't want to pick up the labels yet, that's fine. We'll do that later. Or you can. They're back there on the podium. The boxes are back there. We have tons more boxes. So you can take as many as you want. As soon as those are gone, I'll bring some more down from upstairs. But anyway, we'll talk about that later. But that is a great big ministry that we do every year. We put the videos things in there, and hopefully somebody will speak English and be able to share those with them. But they also put Jesus things in their boxes. So it is a real ministry, and people have been saved just by getting their boxes, and their whole families have been saved all over the world, which is our ministry of ours. So that's the second children's ministry thing. We also do the school supply giveaways. Gideon's gave us lots of Bibles this year. We passed out at least 20 Bibles during what we've been doing with the prayer thing and the thing. So we have at least 20 more people that have the Gideon Bibles that didn't have them. God says his word won't come back void. We're going to trust that. That's a children's ministry. We have a real opportunity to partner with Nauvoo, because Nauvoo, this is the first time. And we've enjoyed partnering with Friendship. It was great, but we weren't close together. It's a real opportunity we have for the community to see two churches in close proximity, not competing, working together and trying to reach people for God and to do things to help the community and to reach out to the children. They're having a wonderful thing on Halloween called Light the Night, which I think is a wonderful name. I love that. And it's like our trunk or treat used to be. People, we pass out candy. It gives the people a safe place to come on Halloween and to see Christian love and some scriptures passed out and different things. There's all sorts of things going on. Kevin and I are going to do it. I think some other people are, but I want to challenge as many of you as can to participate in that. And it's up at their church, and that's a real children's ministry. It's wonderful. And it's an opportunity for us to work together with other Christians. Okay, and then, let's see, we have at Christmas time, we do our food pantry, and Mary Lou has, and the ladies, they put up a tree back there, and we have names on them. We've had a real ministry with that in the past, and I expect we will again when we pass out gifts to the children. It really makes a difference to those families. Those families feel love, and they really feel the love of God, and that's what we're trying to do. And then the other one that we'll focus on later is the drive-through Bethlehem out front. And I know some people think, well, I can't do that, but you can do something. We want it to have everybody in the church participate in some way. If nothing else, you can buy a tea light candle ring to put in one of the tents, or you can buy a painter's cloth to put around one of the, you know, at Lowe's, those canvas tarps to put around one of the easy ups to make it look like a tent. I mean, there's a lot of things, or tablecloths to throw over a chair so it won't look like a folding chair. So we'll talk about all that later. But the thing about children that breaks my heart today is that most of them will not associate Jesus with Christmas at all. They have a lot of things going on at Christmas, but Jesus is not one of them. And some of them, the only time they hear the word Jesus spoken is if somebody's using it as a cuss word. And we have to change that. God has given me just a real heart for the children. The children in our country and our world are in trouble. There's an all-out assault against them. And if they come through our drive-through Christmas, they'll say, this is different. What is this? And maybe that's the spark for the whole family to know about Jesus and start their salvation experience. So that's our hope, and we want everybody involved. Okay, and there's one more thing that we do, and that's to pray, and I'm going to ask you to do that with me right now, okay? Our Father, we know you love the children. Thank you that you've given us a love for children. Thank you that this church has had a great children's ministry throughout its life. We have been concerned and frankly outright scared that we're so small. And we sometimes feel like we can't do things because we're small. But children are small too, and you love them. And you love small churches. And you use small things. That way your glory is shown, because it can't obviously be us. It has to be you. So we ask you to take the children of our community and our country and our world and send your spirit to call them and tell them that you love them, and help us to know how to reach them, and help all the churches in the area and all the Christians to reach out to the children. And I ask you to let us partner in this together and bless our ministries that we have given to you, because they're yours, and help us to make them ours. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'd like to say something real quick about Ann. I'm after all the trunk, because she's I hope now the Lord will do this. I hope he's going to do this.
I forgot to do one thing, and I'll show you. Some of the art projects that we do, some people think it's just coloring pages. This is a family art we did for Easter. Some lessons are long, some are short. This is a great lesson. It's lesson 16. If you want to watch one, this is the Bible. This is Jesus calling the disciples lesson, where he pulls the fish up. And then we have, like, this is the one. It's in that thing. This is about the art we did for the seeds. And this is a parable of the weeds, where they make the weeds and they grow up together and then they separate them. So there's a lot of different art projects that we've done. So you can kind of check out the brochures, and that way if you watch one, you kind of know what they are, and you can tell some child or some adult, because adults are enjoying them too, I think. But we won't have them anymore, so thank you.
I'll say one more thing about our drive-thru yesterday. It was all, because it was kind of slow, and Cameron came in and he said, I think Melvin just closed down. So he was all, I don't know where he was at. But anyway, 1:30, at 1:30, this is what God does. This lady came through, and she was almost crying. She said, this is so wonderful. wonderful. I'm so thankful you're doing this. She said, will you pray for my brother, who is an alcoholic? And I haven't seen him sober in over a month. And we prayed with her. She said, you don't know what we've done for that one moment that we think all is not. God says, I'm sending you someone. I'm sending you someone. And we're so thankful for that. It is a good thing. I promise that. Keep them out of shape.
Our closing hymn will be, oh, wait a minute, no, I'm sorry. No, this is, I thought we had a sermon there. But anyway, many one. How about birthday anniversary this past week? Uh-oh, hands up. All right. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear loved one. Happy birthday to you.
65.
Oh, the big 6-5. All right, how about then we stand and sing hymn number 297 out of the blue hymnal, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. Seated.
I wonder this morning if any of you have a prayer concern you'd like to share with the group that we might pray with you, or if you have a praise testimony you'd like to share. Jennifer? I was there. Can I give them to you? You don't want to know. I'll just tell you that way. Is that right? He was flown to Cabo Huntington Hospital. Another little boy was flown to UC Children's. And the third one only sustained a gash on his forehead, so he was okay. But a lot of trauma, a lot of upset people. And the youngest one that I helped pull up out of the creek, just all he could do was shake and moan. It was bad. It was bad. So please keep those boys in your prayers. Thank you for bringing that up, Jennifer. Terry? Yeah.
See, my sister-in-law, Barbara Will, has been constantly trying to pack the large kitchen stuff, so she's pretty miserable. And her daughter, Emily, because she needs to pack herself, and she's very worried about another. She's not doing the world's most stress.
Okay.
So pray for Emily to Barbara.
Yeah. Others? Mary Lou? That's what we will pray for.
And thank you, all our family got back home safely last week. This one's leaving tomorrow.
Safe travels, Kathy.
The Melanie Ogg family, she passed away.
Yeah. Travel mercies. A lot of folks traveling. Pat's traveling today. Did I hear you all were going to be traveling? Oh, then I heard wrong. Okay. And you're traveling Thursday? Is that a fact? An Ashland police officer. I am going to have to behave myself. I go there often. Yeah, I bet. Yeah, that'll go over good. That's wonderful. Praise the Lord for that.
I'm also thankful for you.
Easy. Thank you.
And I'm thankful for this drive-through prayer.
Yes.
Yes.
I'm thankful for everybody that participated.
Yes.
Others really need to come out and see how it's done.
It's a great thing. I'm going to piggyback a little bit on what one of the things that Ann talked about. You have to understand, my house is Operation Christmas Child Central for the West Side, okay? Trish has been involved in this for 15 years or more. Our house is full of stuff that's gonna end up in a shoebox at some point in time. And we get boxes every day. That's not an exaggeration, of stuff that either she orders or other people order, and it comes to the house, and I have to carry it. So I'm the TLC guy, tote, load, and carry. But last year, Nauvoo did 830 some shoe boxes. I want to tell y'all something. I'm not satisfied with 19, 20, or 21. We can do 50.
Do
you hear what I'm saying? We can do 50.
And next week I'll talk more about how you can find stuff cheaply. There's good stuff.
Mm-hmm. And the reason I say that, it's not about the numbers. What it's about is we get cards and letters and emails and text messages from children all over the world when they get their shoe boxes and how excited they are. And then the follow-up to that is there's a 12-week training program that pastors in the area go through with the children. The children who get shoe boxes are invited to come and go through this training program, and it's the gospel in a message they can understand. We get videos back from these pastors showing us the children as they're worshiping, as they're learning, as they're accepting Christ. That's what it's about. Yep. So pray about it. Pray about it. And let's see what God can do. Okay? Anyone else? Have an unspoken concern? I'm sure there are others. Any others? Father God, in the name of Jesus, we lift our hearts up to you today because the word says that we can boldly approach your throne. And we need not fear. We need not have anxiety. Matter of fact, the word teaches us to cast all our cares on you because you care about us. And so we come to you today, Lord, on behalf of these three boys that were injured in the ATV accident yesterday. We pray that wherever they are, you will minister to them and their families. We pray for all those involved in the situation in Boston. The victim's family, the one who has been accused and arrested, and all their families, Lord, I just ask that you'll wrap your arms around all of them. We pray for Barb and Emily and their respective concerns. We pray for Junior and pray, Lord, that this medication will address his issues and may help him to feel better. We pray for the Melanie Aug family. We pray for all those who will be traveling or are already on the roads. God, may your mercies go before them. And for all these unspoken requests, thank you, Lord, that you know what they are and you know what's going on. Pray that you'll bless the remainder of our time here today together. Give us ears to hear and hearts that are ready to receive. In Jesus' name we pray. And we also pray together, Lord, our Lord's Prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And if Danny and Mark will come forward, we'll worship with our tithes and offerings.
God, in your wisdom, you call us to be sacrificial, to offer to you and to others what they could not receive of themselves, and how we can use the resources that you place in our hands to glorify you. I pray, Father, today your blessing upon this offering and upon all of us as we seek to serve you. here and now in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
And remain standing. We'll sing out of the blue hymnal number 359, Alas, and Did My Savior Bleed? We'll do verses 1, 2, and 5. Please be seated.
Our scripture text this morning comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 21. Matthew 21, I'm going to begin at verse 23. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him while he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one thing, which if you tell me, I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, was from what source? From heaven or from men?" They began reasoning them among themselves, saying, "If we say from heaven, then he will say to us, 'Then why did you not believe him?' But if we say from men, we fear the people, for they all regard John as a prophet." So answering Jesus, they said, "We don't know." He also said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. But what do you think? A man had two sons. He came to the first and said, 'Son, go work today in the vineyard.' And the son answered, 'I will not.' But afterward he regretted it, and he went. The man came to the second, and he said the same thing, and the son answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of these two did the will of his father?" They said, "Well, the first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you that tax collectors and prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you. John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and prostitutes did believe him. And you, seeing this, did not even feel remorse afterward so as to believe him." It seems like, as I have gotten older, and I have hopefully grown in grace and matured in my faith and learned how to live in this world, I've discovered something that I just would not accept when I was in my teens and 20s, and that is, there's always someone in authority over you. Always. Somebody has authority over each one of us. No one gets a free license. It's just the way it is. Now, when I was young, I would listen to that, and I really didn't want to accept it. I was my own authority. And that got me into a lot of trouble. I hope you didn't have that problem, because sometimes it was very unpleasant. But the reality is, we have to recognize that we have authority in our lives. Someone has authority over us. But sometimes if we work hard and we behave ourselves and we prepare ourselves, we will receive some kind of an authority over someone else. Take Terry Joe, for instance, having served 20 years in the United States Navy. Every time she rose in rank, she gained a little bit more authority, right? Or let's take your son, who is fixing to start a career in law enforcement. And as he progresses, he will hopefully move up the ladder, maybe become a sergeant. Like my grandfather was a police sergeant. I know you all find that hard to believe. I got to tell you, every time my name, they kept a scanner. Grandma and Grandpa kept a scanner on the kitchen. She had an island thing in the kitchen, and they kept it on there. And every time my name came across the scanner, I had to go explain myself. And see, they didn't miss it because I was named after my grandfather. So it came across the scanner, Willard Shaffer. Grandpa heard that. So there's that authority thing. But, you know, Grandpa was a sergeant. And maybe he'll work his way up to sergeant, maybe detective, lieutenant, whatever. And in the school system, right, we have staff, teachers, administrators, and lunch ladies, in that order. Anyway, there's always authority. But sometimes we don't know where it comes from. Sometimes we don't understand it. And a lot of times we want to ignore it. We have a bad habit of wanting to ignore authority. Jesus, this passage of Scripture recounts a time during Jesus' final week on earth. They've already had the triumphant entry into Jerusalem, where he rode into town on the colt, and people were waving the palm branches and laying their cloaks in the road and shouting Hosanna and praising God. They'd already had that day. And he'd gone into the temple and he'd thrown out the money changers, overturning their tables and scattering their stuff everywhere. And the Bible says he even made a cord of nine strands, you know, one of the, like he was going to whoop somebody with it, you know. And so when the elders and the chief priests and all those folks came to him, they wanted, and here Jesus was coming to the temple every day, and he was teaching the people, the crowds. He would gather a crowd around him, and he would teach them the ways of God. And they wanted to know, look, dude, who do you think you are? First of all, I'm sure among those who came to him was the captain of the temple. This was the guy who was in charge to make sure that everything in the temple operated smoothly, the way it was supposed to. And when Jesus went in and upset the tables and threw out the money changers, that kind of got under his crow. And then Jesus was teaching the people these wonderful lessons about living a life that becomes the gospel, and the elders and the scribes especially, whose job it was to interpret the scripture and help the people understand. This was nothing like they had ever taught before. And I'm sure they were bothered by what they were hearing. But most of all were the chief priests, who had the positions they had because they were in cahoots with the Roman authorities. Remember, the Romans were the authority at the time. And if you start stirring up trouble, the Romans are going to get upset, and we might lose our jobs. We might lose our prestige. We might lose our power. And we don't want that. We want to be in control. We want everything to operate smoothly and copacetic, and we don't want any problems. So why in the world are you doing this? Jesus, who do you think you are? And every day, they ask that question. Who does he think he is? Until they finally confronted him. And so Jesus said, well, yeah, no, that's a good question, and I'd love to answer it, but I want to ask you one first. How about John? Was he from God? Or was he just another loudmouth? Some coconut head out in the desert yelling and screaming and eating locusts. And they had to huddle up. You know, they were like, let's see here. What are we going to do? Okay, if we say he's from God, then Jesus will wonder why we didn't pay attention to him. If we say he's just another guy, the people will revolt because they think John was a prophet. And so they came back with the standard children's sermon answer. I don't know. When I do children's sermon, I get one of two answers. The first answer is, we don't know. The second answer, Jesus. Those are the only two answers I ever get. Jesus said, well, if you're not going to answer my question, I'm not going to answer yours. You figure it out. But I will tell you a story. It's almost like they listen to Jesus and they're just getting ready to turn around, and then Jesus says, but I will tell you a story. I will give you a lesson. And they kind of stop, you know, turn their heads back. Man went to the boys. Son, that vineyard needs some tending to. Get out there. Have that like my dad used to on Saturdays. Especially after football games. Grass needs cut. So? Hit it. And I would stumble down the stairs and do my best to make it look like it's been mowed. He went to the first one and said, go in the vineyard. Not going to do it, Dad. I got plans. I have my life to live. I want to do things my way. You ever said stuff like that before? Maybe not out loud. Maybe not in so many words. But you know, sometimes God lays stuff on our hearts. And we'll do anything and everything we can to forget about it or to ignore it. That person that you see in the checkout line who has three kids and they're all screaming and running around and they need help. We can choose to be like the rest of the people in the checkout line and go, why doesn't she get a babysitter? Why do I have to always get behind somebody like that? Or I'm going to pick on myself this morning. Why is it every time I want to drive up 104 and 73 and I'm in a hurry, I get behind somebody who's going 40? And I question why they even have a driver's license or own a car. My favorite saying is, if you can't drive it, you shouldn't own it. That's my problem. I know you guys don't have that problem. That's me. But we take on some kind of an authority, like we know what's best and God doesn't. Or there's the second son. Sure, Dad, I can do that. No problem. And then he finds something else better. Now, the chief priests and the Pharisees and all those guys, they knew who Jesus was talking about. They knew what he was up to. They got the message. But did they heed the message? No. Well, you know what? Every time we come to this communion table, we have to ask ourselves the same question. Who's really in control here? Is it me or is it Christ? Am I calling the shots? Am I making up the rules? Am I imposing my will on God? Am I telling God, hey, this is the best possible way to do it. You're not paying attention. Or are we yielding and submitting to Christ's authority? And if we come to this communion table with an improper attitude or a non-contrite heart, or with unrepented sin, we're wasting our time and God's. Now, I don't say that to keep people from coming to take communion. I believe Jesus wants us all to be a part of what he's offering. He's the one that's the host. He's the one who's saying, come. I mean, let's face facts. He even let Judas in. He even let Peter in. Even when Peter said, you're not going to wash my feet, pal. Nuh-uh. And Jesus said, look, if you don't let me do this, you don't have any part in what I'm doing. So let's prepare ourselves by recognizing who's really in control. Who has the ultimate authority? It's not you and me. And for some of us, that's a hard pill to swallow. We like to think we're in control. We like to know that everything's going to go just exactly the way it should be because that's how we planned it. It's not up to us. It's not our call. We are not to challenge Jesus' authority. Let's come to the table of the Lord this morning, recognizing that he's in control. And we must submit ourselves to his will and his purpose and his design for our lives. Let's pray together. Father, I want to thank you. I thank you for the Pharisees and the chief priests and the captain of the temple and whoever else was in that crowd that came to Jesus that day and asked him about his authority. Because we can all see ourselves in that crowd somewhere. And we all need to learn the same lesson they did. That it's not up to us. We don't even presume to come to your table today, Lord, based on our accomplishments or our position or our power or our authority. We don't have any of that. We come this morning because, first of all, Lord, you've invited us to come. But secondly, Lord, we come because we need more of Jesus. Please forgive us. Have mercy on us. For those times in our lives when we try to do things our way, when we ignore you or we disobey you, we're just out and out obstinate. We plead the blood of Christ. Cover our sins, to grant us forgiveness, an opportunity to do it over and do it right. We remember that on that night when Jesus gathered with his friends in the upper room, that they were celebrating that what would become Jesus' final Passover meal. And in the midst of that time together, Jesus took bread and he broke the script and he said, "This is my body." And he blessed it and he shared it with them and he said, "Take and eat." And then when the meal was completed, he took the cup of redemption, and poured that wine into that cup and held it up in front of all of them. He said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, the new promise that's poured out for the forgiveness of sins." Lord, I ask your blessing upon these elements of bread and the vine. May they be for us the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. And as we receive them, may we become more like the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood in service in this world. Have compassion on your people, Lord. In the name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Ushers, you may take the bread. This is the body of Christ. Take, eat, and be thankful. You may take the cup. This is the blood of Christ. Take, drink, and be thankful. May the mercies of God extend to each one of us and through us this day and forevermore. Amen. You may be seated. You may take the bread. This is the body of Christ. Take, eat, and be thankful. You may take the cup. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take, drink, and be thankful. May the peace and power of Christ be yours this day and forever. Amen. You may go. You may take the bread, the body of Christ given for you. Take, eat, and be thankful. You may take the cup. Christ's blood shed for you. Take, drink, and be thankful. May the richness of Christ's mercy be with us each day and forevermore. Amen. May go in peace. Let's all stand together. Take my life and let it be.
Thank you.
Before I pronounce the benediction, Ann reminded me of something that I should have brought up during the announcements. This coming Saturday, we have scheduled a trip to the White Gravel Mines for their Cavern of Choices. And if you would like to go, you're welcome to go and join with us. But I need to know if you're planning on going. So give me a call this week or drop me a text, send up a smoke signal, something. Let me know that you're interested in going so I can make sure I have a proper count for them, because they want to know that. So if you're interested in going with us, we're going to leave at 5 o'clock. Our scheduled tour starts at 6. And then, we'll leave from up there. We'll come down here and we'll go from here. Okay, so we'll be here just a couple minutes after 5. So, come and join us. Should be a good time. I've never been to the Cavern of Choices. I've been to the Christmas Cave several times. But this is a whole different ball game. This is something, and if you have unsaved friends, I hope you know somebody unsaved. Because if you don't, you're not getting out enough. Okay? This will be a great opportunity to introduce the gospel to them. All right? Receive the benediction. May the peace of God, which is beyond anything we could ever imagine or contemplate, be ours this day and forevermore. Amen.